Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. I'm here to tell you about four simple steps which you can use to breathe life into your stories. Now, I know that sounds like a very odd concept because all of us think of stories as inanimate objects, right? But believe me, with a little bit of magic, a little bit of science, and a whole lot of faith, we can make this happen. But before heading there, let us talk about the stories themselves. I think we can all agree that stories have a very powerful, a very profound influence on all of us. Why is that? Stories are part of our evolution. In fact, discoveries have been made where they found that cavemen used to carve out their stories on the rock faces of their homes. It was probably for communication. Maybe they wanted to preserve a record of their life. But the important thing is the stories have survived through that, and they proved that stories were there at the very beginning. The cavemen are gone, but the stories are still around. I find that really beautiful. Personally, for me, my grandmothers used to share stories from Indian mythology. We used to pester them for more and more stories. And my personal favorite was the story of baby Krishna. I made my grandmother say it so often, I knew it by heart. And then she'll make me sit and entertain any guests who come home with that story. It was my first lesson in public speaking, and it was a very valuable one because today I get paid to share my stories with whoever's willing to listen. So I owe my grandmothers a huge debt of gratitude. When I say that stories evoke a very powerful response in us, I'm not just stating a random thing out there. There is actual science behind it. Way back in 2006, studies conducted in Spain showed that stories activate the language processing areas of the brain while simultaneously triggering multiple parts of the brain. If you were to visualize it, it's like light bulbs going inside your head. Your entire brain is lit up like a theme park. Now, ordinarily, that would take a lot of effort, okay, to get that kind of response from the brain, whereas stories do it just like that. Even more recently, a study conducted by Stanford, it showed that when statistics are used to drive home a point, retention is only about 5 to 10%. When anecdotes are mixed up with the statistics, retention spikes. It increases to about 65 to 70%, which is a huge deal. It explains why we respond more to stories than bullet point reports and slideshows, presentations of that sort. It also explains why I was really, really bad at statistics, physics, maths, subjects like that. Unfortunately, despite the best efforts of my teachers, I did not really learn much from my maths and physics textbook. In fact, I can barely do simple maths. And physics, I've learned only one principle, and that is the Archimedes principle. And even that is because there was a really cool story involved. So picture this. One of the greatest thinkers of the age, he's been given a very strenuous task by his king. He decides to relax. There's a tub full of water, very commonplace activity. He steps into that tub. The water spills out. They weren't very environment conscious back then, unfortunately. So he didn't worry about that. Instead, he was inspired. He had an idea. And in a state of undress, he ran on the street screaming, "Eureka, Eureka!" And thanks to him, there was a principle which came to be used to design ships, submarines, even hot air balloons. So I think I also need to thank the storyteller who chronicled this story to help me learn at least a little bit of physics. And now that we have established the science behind the stories, let us begin with our four simple steps. Step one, I call it a good diet. Please say it after me. What is step one? A good diet. Thank you very much. We are what we eat. Now, that's not a cliche. It's just a simple fact. I love baked cheesecake. I love anything with sugar in it. That's why I have such an unhealthy, hostile relationship with my waistline. But jokes aside, when we take the stories themselves, I would recommend consuming a steady diet of stories. I would say that we need to read, read, and read some more. so that the stories become a part of our blood, our bones, our very being, should allow the stories to shape our personalities, to influence the kind of people we become. They say in order to lead the world, you need to read. It is that important. Reading, there are so many benefits to it. It improves your mental faculties, your analytical skills, communication skills, powers of comprehension. It expands your vocabulary. I can go on and on and on. Which is why I would say that, you know, I can't stress the importance of step one enough. Okay, shall we say step one again? What's the step one? A good diet. Thank you. We've established that. We'll move on to step two. I call it sharing is loving. Now we teach our children this. We teach them to please share their toys, all their sweets, everything, because it's a valuable lesson to share. But in the context of stories, I personally feel that stories are living things. They grow and evolve just like us. So when it comes to stories that we hear, the stories we read, or the stories that are bubbling inside us, when we take it, put it inside a box and store it away in the brain, the story tends to suffocate. There's no room for it to breathe. It's a cruel thing to do, right? You wouldn't do that to a puppy, right? So please don't do it to a story either. Take it out, share it with an audience, okay? Now children are a great audience to share your stories with. Today's world, so many people complain that children are suffering from attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, or that they are addicted to their gaming devices, their smartphones, their tabs. Parents are always complaining about that. But the truth is, children as well as adults cannot resist a good story. This was true in the beginning of time. It is true today. So please take a little time out to share a few stories with children and adults. It's practically a vocation, and it's a beautiful way to make a difference in today's world. So what's step two? Sum it up for me. Is loving. Thank you very much. And now step three. Step three is also very simple. It is practice the art and craft of storytelling. Now, again, we are all taught from school that practice makes perfect. We are taught that. We know that in order to succeed at anything at all, we need to practice. We can't just get up one morning and say, okay, I'm going to become a success story. That's only the first step. You need to practice, practice, practice. But I wouldn't emphasize the perfection part of it. Storytelling is a journey. Along the way, there may be mistakes. While you're telling a story, there may be an awkward pause. You may forget important details. You may add some of your own. That doesn't matter. Every time a story is retold, you add something to it. You know, it's a metamorphosis. The story evolves into something else. It's a great way not to allow the stories to stagnate. This way, stories evolve the same as us. So as long as you care about the stories, as long as you respect them, don't worry about repeating it perfectly. Just keep saying the stories, just keep practicing. Now, in Indian mythology, there's a beautiful story about the importance of practice. We're all familiar with the story. It's about Arjuna, my favorite. His ambition was to become the greatest archer, the mightiest warrior this world has seen. He did achieve his ambition because he was so committed to it. He had such a grueling practice routine and he stuck to it every single day. One day, all his cousins, his brothers, they'd all finished eating. It was dusk. He went to eat late. They lit a lamp for him. There was a gust of wind. The lamp goes out. But he continued to eat. And he noticed that he didn't even pause because it was such a habit. He knew it was a natural extension of himself. That's when he realized when you do something often enough, it becomes easy, like breathing or sleeping or eating. We don't think about it, but we do it every day. So I would suggest that you practice the stories till it feels very, very natural. It's a part of you. It's an extension of who you are. That's step three. What's step three? Practice the art and craft of storytelling. And now we come to my last step, my favorite, step number four. I call it love the stories and live the stories. Okay? As of now, storytelling is a very organic process. We don't have a software or an app where you just put in a few words and out pops a beautiful story. I'm sure they are working on it. It's probably going to happen in the future. But as it stands now, it's a very artistic, individual, human endeavor. It's a beautiful endeavor. Okay? And now, when you want to succeed as a storyteller, it is very important to surrender yourself completely to the story. It's just a small step, but a huge leap of faith. You have to leave behind the physical world with its gross realities and you have to just enter a make-believe world, okay, where everything is imaginary. But if you believe in it, it is real to you. It is real in your head. Okay, once you enter this world, the characters there become like your friends. They are a part of your life. You are a part of their life. You know each other so well. It becomes a very visual, sensory experience. You can smell, taste, see, and feel what your character does. It's like having a beautiful bond. It's having an imaginary friend who's very real to you. When this happens, when you've entered this world, whether you're writing a story or whether you're just sharing a story, you will notice that the characters don't behave the way you want them to. It's like children or your friends, right? You love them very much, but they're not going to do exactly as you want them to. Those who have husbands, spouses, they're not going to do exactly as you want them to. They all have minds of their own. They're independent. They act according to their will. When your characters start doing that, when they start controlling the flow of the story, you know you've succeeded. All you've got to do is strap yourself in and enjoy the ride. You can go with the flow, go where the story takes you. It can be a very transcendental and transformative experience. It's a beautiful journey and it's totally worth the effort. Now, before I conclude, I want to talk about the human quest for immortality. Since the beginning of time, man, woman, child, the idea is to defeat death, to live forever. In Indian mythology, we have the story where we churn the ocean of milk and we dredge up the nectar of immortality called Amrita. Now in the West, they have similar versions of the story. They have alchemy. They talk about something called the philosopher's stone, which can change base metal to gold. And you can extract an elixir from it, which will help you retain your youth and live forever. Human ambition is so simple, no? We just want all the gold we need. We want to live forever. We want to be young. So simple, right? Human ambition. But I personally feel that the key to immortality lies in the stories themselves. Human beings come, human beings go, but the stories are forever. And when you're part of the storytelling process, you put a little piece of your heart, you put a little piece of your soul in there. The best and most beautiful part of you is preserved in the stories. So when the end comes, it's not so much as about departing one world as it is about entering a new one. A beautiful world where the stories as well as the dreams are very, very real. This is the paradise that we are all possibly striving for. Isn't that a beautiful story? Isn't that a journey worth taking? I personally think so. I hope there's a booker in this award, in this idea of mine. And so in conclusion, I will ask you to repeat step 4. Loudly, love the stories, live the stories. Love the stories, live the stories. And craft your own happily ever after. Thank you very much.